Hi, Dr. Paul here.
Hi, Doctor. Hello, Doctor.
Good afternoon, Dr. Paul.
Hey, Dr. Paul.
Jenna, we're good to go?
Yes, we are.
Good afternoon, everyone. Bon après-midi, tout le monde. Let's get started. Just to give you a bit of an update worldwide, as of this morning, we were at 1.3 million cases with over 70,000 deaths. If you look at the world map, you'd see that probably about half those are in Europe, Spain, Italy, and so on, Germany. But we're also seeing a big number in the United States, over 330,000 with approximately 10,000 deaths. Going down to Canada, we're at 15,500 cases with 280 deaths. More specifically, Quebec has about half of those, but 8,000 with 94 deaths. In Ontario, the numbers are 4,038, including about 1,500 or so that are resolved. It increased 408 from the previous day with 119 deaths as well. We, in terms of some of our hospitalizations, there are about 500 hospitalizations in Ontario at this point with COVID diagnosis, about 200 in the ICU and about 150 of them ventilated. We've had, in terms of our lab testing, as of this morning, there were a couple of hundred tests pending, so they really caught up very nicely. So moving forward, I think we should be seeing, you know, tests pretty rapidly within a day or two turnaround time by the time, you know, it goes to the lab and then they run it. So I think that's good news for us in terms of moving forward. In terms of our local situation, I can tell you that we have, as of this morning, well, as of 2:30 p.m. today, we were at 44 cases total in our area. We still haven't changed our website in terms of the numbers, but we will. Our IP people are working on putting age groups and so on. But if on the current site, you can kind of see that, again, we've put, instead of putting the date of the test coming back positive, we did the date of the symptom onset, which tells us when the disease started. And there's a bit of a, if I don't know if you're online, but if you go back and look at it, there's a bit of a peak kind of between March 14th to around March 26th, where we had a peak, we had like, you know, 5-6 new cases on a daily basis, and they've sort of gone down. So hopefully, you know, hopefully we're really looking at sort of keeping that low. And again, we're going to be monitoring that very closely. One of the things that we know is of our individuals who got infected with COVID, among those, there are currently three in the ICU two others in not ICU. The rest did not require hospitalization out of the 44. One of the things that we're also doing is, again, making sure that we're continuing with our public health measures. On Friday, I issued two Section 22 orders. One was to, again, fill that gap of individuals that don't fall under the Federal Quarantine Act, but essentially people who have COVID diagnosis, COVID suspected, tested, or contact with COVID, or symptoms compatible with COVID, that those individuals have to have a 14-day self-isolation. We've also had, in response to multiple and seemingly continual complaints by the public about stores, retail stores, grocery stores, and so on, where parking lots are full, where people congregate, and there seemingly was no crowd control. We issued the order, and we are now seriously working with our police and bylaw officers to ensure that businesses do adhere to them. I must say that a lot of them have, and the few that haven't are starting to follow our directives. It's also a matter of ensuring the public follows the directives of the stores. Some of the stores clearly have, you know, mechanisms in place that people don't respect them. People don't social distance in the parking lot and so on. So those are the things that we're worried about. Those are the things moving forward. We want to sort of enhance in terms of our efforts to sort of keep that curve as flat as possible. The next week or two, actually the next 2 weeks, is going to be pivotal to us. So that, let's hope that we can sort of collectively move forward and ensure that the situation remains manageable. At this point, it does remain manageable within our hospital setting, but the hospitals are working in that regard. We're also working with our, at this point, we've got the testing centers open in our area. The Rockland one just opened today in partnership with the family health team. There will be a press release with hours of operation and on our website going out tomorrow morning. And so we have a total of 5 testing centers in the Eastern Shore Health Unit area. We've got one in Hawkesbury, we've got one in Castleman, we've got one in now in Rockland, and we've got another one in Winchester, another one in Cornwall, and we have one potential one, but again, working with a hospital to see if there's a need for Alexandria. So that's where we are with those. Again, our goal, our common goal really is to ensure that the hospitals are not overwhelmed, and if there is need for a testing or a medical assessment, these assessment centers are going to continue to offer those what I call diversion services, so people will not go to the emergency room, instead stay. So really, that is the other thing that we're looking at, and I've got a lot of questions about. Well, my concern is we're now really at, you know, at the area where 3 days, you know, 3 or 4 days, we're approaching Easter weekend, long Easter weekend. And again, I urge everybody, please do not get together with your families. I know that it's, for many, it's an important religious holiday, but it's really important, particularly over the next week or two, that we stay at home. We don't gather. Don't go see grandma, those type of things. Stay home. Telephone, virtual kind of connectivity is best. It's well worth doing so together to protect the vulnerable people around us. So that is one of my sort of major preoccupations. Again, is just making sure that we get the message across and that we can make a difference in terms of total numbers. Already we've made a difference by a lot of the public health measures we're doing, and we may have to enhance those moving forward. We're keeping an eye on those. And again, it really is a matter of people help ensuring that they stay home. And again, I need to implore people that please, heed to these. There's, I would say, probably a minority, but still a visible minority of a number of people that are still you're congregating and still acting as if business as usual. Unfortunately, it is not business as usual. It is really a situation where we need to promote this physical distancing and so on. Over the weekend as well, you saw the number of essential workplaces went down to about 43. Again, we're working with our partners and bylaw and police and so on to interpret who is essential, who is not. Again, we take those case by case. Really, that's really how much what I had to say. We have a question, actually, that was sent in. Actually, there's two issues that we got a question on. We had a question that there was rumors that there was a death due to COVID in the area. At this point, we don't have any. I cannot confirm that. There is no, we have no deaths reported to us from COVID. As I said, we have those individuals in hospital, but so far we've had no deaths. So I want to address that directly. And then I had another question. Events in some communities, fairs, festivals that were scheduled for late summer and in the fall have already been canceled due to COVID concerns. Is this something organizers of these events should be doing at this stage, even for festivals that are planned May, June, July? Well, I can tell you that May is around the corner, and I don't see us being able to have mass gatherings between now and May. June and July, I can't say. Again, we'll be in a better position to say to what extent we can sort of going back to gathering. We may go back to just gatherings of 50 or 250, depends. Depends how far we need to go sort of the other way in terms of restriction, and then we will have to play it by ear, so to speak, in terms of what the numbers are, what the hospitalizations are, what our rates of infection are, and those type of things moving forward. So the prudent thing, I've been asked about events in May and June, and I said, yeah, you know what, if you can postpone or cancel, I think would be the right thing to do, particularly if you're expecting thousands of people. I think that just like we kind of went the other way in terms of going from limiting to 250 to 50 to 5, we're going to go progressive the other way. So if festivals are thinking that they're going to have, you know, tens of thousands of people in June or end of May, I think it's unlikely that that's going to happen. So I do agree that festivals should be either canceling or postponing. And again, I unfortunately can't give them a specific date, but May is around the corner, and so is June. So I think that the message is that the rollback of these measures is going to be progressive as well. So that was actually a very good question, because I've gotten a lot of questions from community agencies and other organizers about festivals coming up. So I think that I'd be prudent, and I would, you know, and if they could speak to us as well, but realistically speaking, big events, I don't see them happening May, June, or even possibly July. So we'll see one day at a time when it comes to that. Let me just see if I have, that was the only question I got, so let me
there
see.
There were two additional.
I didn't see the other ones. Sorry, I didn't see the email. Hold on. Do you have them, Jenna?
I do. Would you like me to?
Yeah. Can you just read them out to me? That will save me from searching in my email box here.
Sure. So one of the questions was in regards to the safety of visiting the ER, because some people are worried about going there.
Well, first of all, people should not go to the ER if not necessary. However, people need to go to the ER. If they have symptoms, they should let the ER know. The emergency rooms are very well placed for making sure that people with suspected COVID or any other respiratory infection is not put in the same place as others in their waiting room. But I think that you have to be aware. You have to, again, when you're there, you know, wash your hands and so on. But if you need to go, you need to go, obviously. The emergency rooms are taking all necessary precautions, both to ensure that when a suspected patient with COVID comes in, is isolated, and at the same time, keep that individual away from other patients. Some of the hospitals have actually had separate ER, separate entrances for COVID suspected patients or anybody with respiratory symptoms and so on. So I think that, again, my message is if necessary, you need to go. People can need, you know, have a fracture or something happens in an emergency, they need to go. But again, hospitals have mechanisms in place to be able to protect those that are not COVID positive, you know, that are not suspected of COVID, that have non-COVID related issues. What's the next one, Jenna?
It's about recommendations in regards to face masks, in particular the homemade face mask.
You know what? That's what I wanted to talk about, and I forgot. I had a note to talk about that, so let's talk about it. Two things. The first thing to tell you is that those medical-grade face masks should be reserved only for healthcare providers. Healthcare providers use those to, A, protect themselves and also protect the patient, but more to protect themselves. But in combination with face shields, gloves, gowns, caps, and so on. The issue is that a medical mask on its own, if you're wearing the medical mask on its own, on your own, you're not protecting your eyes. If you scratch the mask, for example, or touch the mask, let's say has a virus on it, which you can't see, it's invisible, then you'll contaminate yourself if you don't wash your hands. So there's all these protective protocols that we have for people like working in the emergency room or frontline, you know, essential workers and so on, that have a protocol with those masks. And in that context, the person wearing the mask is fully protected. Having said that, an individual who wears, again, a mask, you know, a medical grade or a homemade mask really is not optimally protecting him or herself from the COVID or any other type of respiratory virus, because the virus can get into their eye, the virus can scratch their nose, sometimes people touch the mask, there's all kinds of things, they're not wearing gloves and so on. So the advice that we have right now is that for those issues, you need to have full protective gear to be 100%, to be really protected at a high level. Now, homemade masks, you know, particularly cloth masks and so on. The CDC just sent out, you know, how to make them and what they're good for. Well, if we tell people if they sneeze or cough, what do we tell them? We tell them either sneeze into your sleeve, cough into your sleeve, or cough into a handkerchief and throw the handkerchief away and wash your hands. So essentially, those masks, what they would do, like a homemade mask, if somebody would wear them, would protect the wearer, the person that's wearing the mask, from spreading any germs. That individual is not necessarily protected him or herself by wearing just that mask. However, some people may want to, and again, these are not recommendations. This is just advice that we're giving. If people can't social distance, let's say they're in a context where they want to make sure they're not too close to somebody and they don't want to infect that person, they could put the mask on. But importantly, when you wear that mask, you should know that you're protecting others, not yourself, and that you should still have social distancing and really washing hands and hand hygiene and all that other important information and directives that we've given. So the bottom line is that medical grade should be for healthcare providers. If people fear, like I can tell you that if, let's say, we knew that there's a high chance of an individual, you know, is infectious or has potentially, you know, is shedding a virus and so on and doesn't know it or has mild symptoms, then wearing those homemade masks may prevent that individual from shedding that virus, but it won't protect them. So we leave it to the public, but they need to understand that please do not misinterpret the fact that you're wearing a homemade mask as protecting you from COVID or any other respiratory virus. You still need to be, you're protecting others in case you have the virus, but you're not really protecting yourself in the way that the mask and other healthcare workers use it. So again, always remember social distancing, washing hands, hand hygiene, disinfection of surfaces is the first and most important thing you should be doing. And if you choose to wear a homemade mask, make sure you're not complacent and say, oh, I've got the homemade mask, I don't need to do the other measures. You still need to do the other measures. So that's long story, but long answer, but that's really the latest way that we're thinking about masks.
Dr. Paul,
an additional question.
Yes, Dr. Paul.
An additional question that came in was about the situation at... Yes.
Go ahead.
The three more additional questions, quite short. The situation at the Glen Store Dunn Lodge.
So far, the Glen Store Dunn Lodge is negative. Well, there's no COVID in that outbreak, and we're keeping an eye on it.
And is there a shortage of PPE in the SD&G area?
Well, we do at this point. We do have probably another week and a half worth of PPE in the area. We are now looking at reusing PPE. We've had a directive from the federal government and from the provincial government to keep PPE in the hospitals so they could be decontaminated and reused. We're also being told that any day now we should be receiving a massive supply, so we're crossing our fingers. But at this point, they've got another week or two to go with the current PPE levels. And then I know that the governments, I think, are looking at either reusing PPE, decontaminating it, and or we will be receiving a big supply.
And
any other questions, Jenna? Otherwise, we'll go to the press.
The final one that I have is in regards to the status, particular status of the COVID-19 patients in Cornwall ICU.
Both those patients are still vented, but are stable.
That's all on my end. Thank you.
Okay. Let's go. I got some questions there.
Yeah, Dr. Paul, Bill Kingston, Cornwall.
Yes, Bill.
We've had some people reach out to us that are concerned in South Glengarry specifically. As you know, Quebec police have set up checkpoints to make sure that non-essential travel is going into Quebec. The same can't be said for coming the other way. And a lot of people have reached out to us in Bainesville, Lancaster, saying there's unnecessarily people that are probably doing unnecessary activities in their communities, basically putting the local population at risk. They said they reached out to the health unit, and the EOHU said that they would look into it and agreed it wasn't a good situation. I guess, what are your thoughts on that, and is it an unlevel playing field about restrictions?
I agree with you, Bill. This is something that has been concerning me all day. I heard about it. I heard that what happened was, to compound issues, is that I think on Fridays or Sundays, Quebec closes their stores. And I had reports. As a matter of fact, I just came off a call with MP Eric Duncan and MPP Jim McDonnell with some of our mayors, and we all talked about that. And this is one of my concerns. I do have a concern about that. I've brought it up to our ministry. I brought it up to government. I brought it into governmental affairs. Jim McDonnell and Eric are very well aware this has to be dealt with. Do we have a curfew the other way? Yes, that's part of our plan. If you look at our extension of our public health measures, we would be saying, no, you can't come here for non-essential reasons. These people came in and shopped because their stores were closed. I don't consider that essential, and I do agree with you fully. I raised it literally half an hour ago before I came on this call.
Okay, so just a follow-up. So you're looking at speaking with the ministry and seeing if the OPP can do something as far as
regulating. Yes, yes. So those are more interprovincial affairs. So from the health point of view, I think it's important that we limit traffic both ways.
Right.
You know, like, we should be limiting non-essential traffic coming to us and the other way around. But you're right. We have to look at the playing field to be level. And so this is something that we're working with. Like I said, this is beyond my health unit's jurisdiction, but I strongly recommend that some measures are made, because we can't have people coming in for non-essential reasons.
Thank you.
Dr. Paul, Philip Blanchard, Morrisburg Leader.
Yes.
I've got sort of two things that are related. One, how is the supply of testing materials holding up?
Well, I just got good news this morning that I'm getting another 1,500 swabs within the next couple of days. We're good.
And the second one is sort of a follow-up to a question I asked a couple of weeks ago. Do you have a more accurate number now of how many ventilators are actually in the EOHU service area, not the Champlain-Lynn, but more towards the four hospitals in the EOHU?
You know what? I don't have those numbers. I will get them for you, I promise.
Okay.
I keep forgetting. There's so many things to do. Sorry about that.
No problem. You're handling a lot right now.
Dr. Paul?
Yes.
Greg Chamberlain for the Tribune.
Yes, Greg.
Press. What's the PPE situation then for Prescott Russell region as far as
similar to the SDNG? We got another week and a half to go. Full PPE. We're trying to get some donations of some N95s, for example, that have expired. We're going to try to bring them up. We're trying to see how we can reuse them, and we're hoping, like crossing our fingers, like we were told by the ministry that there is a federal order that is coming imminently. So hopefully we'll be able to get that distribution going within the next couple of days.
Okay.
So it's the same as SDNG.
Well, I got two other questions, but I'll wait till somebody else has had their chance first.
Dr. Paul, Nelson Zandbergen, Nation Valley News. If somebody is in self-quarantine because they've tested positive, do they need to have another test to prove that they're negative in order to be released from quarantine situation?
That's a good question. That depends on what job they're doing. If they are not healthcare workers, no. After 14 days of isolation, they can go. We don't test them anymore. But the retesting only applies to healthcare workers.
Okay, I just had an unrelated follow-up. How many days are we behind the United States in terms of deaths per million? It looks to me like about 6 days on a consistent basis.
Probably. I haven't done the math, but I don't know. I have to look at the math. Thanks. Next question.
No, Greg Chamberlain again. I did say I had two. If nobody else had anything else, if I can ask them now.
Yeah, go ahead. I just somebody just gave me a sign here that the Prime Minister of Britain was just moved to ICU.
What's the total 30-plus cases for Eastern Ontario? Has the Prescott-Russell region, has R10 caseload changed at all, or is there?
Yeah, we've got increases both in SDNG. So the original 10 were all from Prescott-Russell, but now they're from all over. So they're increasing almost equally, SDNG, Cornwall, Prescott-Russell, from all over, all corners. So that's why I'm not really telling people where they are from anymore, because I don't want people to be complacent, and I don't want it to be a race. You know, we have five cases, you've got 20, so we're better. No, I mean, we're better off, we're okay, let's not socially distance. I don't want people to get into that false sense of security. And I can tell you that our neighboring health units don't report exactly where they're from either.
Which segues into my other question is we've been getting some feedback from a few people on our Facebook pages asking why there's no specific municipalities or such mention as the location for confirmed cases.
Yeah, and I keep answering them too. I've answered them all weekend.
Thanks very much for that.
Well, I want people to realize that it's here, that COVID-19 is in our area. That's the message, and I count on you guys to share that with me.
Yes,
share it for me. Thank you.
I have a question.
Take one more.
Quebec and patients coming to Hawkesbury to be tested, and the staff reported to us if it was divided from, let's say, provincial-wise. If
c'est les Québécois. Rien en français. Dis-le en français, on va répondre en français.
Je sais qu'il y a des Québécois qui viennent se faire tester à Hawkesbury parce que les critères pour recevoir un test ont récemment changé. Est-ce qu'ils étaient séparés sur le plan statistique?
Non, on les a, mais on ne les publie pas. Mais par contre, on a parmi les patients qui viennent, on teste les Québécois aussi. La plupart, par exemple, viennent d'Ontario. Les personnes qui, disons que quelqu'un qui teste positif de Québec, on fait le suivi avec l'agence à Québec pour faire le suivi, parce qu'il faut faire le suivi des contacts, etc.
Okay. Il y a combien de tests qui ont été effectués ici dans la région? Il y en a combien en attente déjà?
J'ai pas les données, mais je vais les avoir demain. J'ai pas les données. La semaine passée, on avait, je pense, à Hawkesbury. Je peux pas vous dire. J'ai pas des données devant moi, mais je vais les avoir demain pour vous.
OK. Mon deadline est à demain midi.
Pardon?
Bon, est-ce qu'on peut les avoir en avant-midi demain?
Oui, je vais les avoir pour vous parce que je les ai, mais je les ai pas devant moi. Je l'ai pas devant moi, donc je vais les avoir. N'oubliez pas qu'on rajoute Castleman et puis on rajoute Rockland à ça aussi.
Oui.
OK, merci.
Francis Racine with the Cornell Standard Freeholder.
Yes.
Dr. Paul, I was wondering, how many cases, how many patients have COVID at the Cornell Hospital?
There's three.
Three? And are they all in the ICU? Or?
No, two are in the ICU, one is not.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay.
Sounds good. Thank you. Yep.
Thank you very much, everybody. See you tomorrow.
Yeah,
by the way, I want to ask somebody, please don't hang up. Are you good if I do a Zoom for these press conferences moving forward?
Pardon me.
Sure. Yep.
Okay. So we'll try to get the Zoom going. Okay?
Sounds good.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay, thanks. Bye.